Can we all just settle down, please? Could everyone just settle into their chairs, please? And we have some silence. As we can see, we've got a formidable panel of the superior gender here today. Starting off with Maliha Lodi, who is, as everyone knows, a distinguished journalist who subsequently went into diplomacy and has now returned to the media. She served as Pakistan's former ambassador in Washington and as a high commissioner in London, and is now senior international advisor for the Jung Group. Beside her is, and to my right, is Aisha Sadiqa, whom I'm sure everyone knows as the author of Military Inc., the book that was published in 2007. She's an academic and a columnist. She also serves as a military and political analyst. And finally, to my left is Tahira Abdullah, tormentor of dictators, misogynist thugs, and Islamabad's preeminent civil society activist. In many ways, it behooves us to raise this question today, as in the month since Salman Taseer's murder, there's been a lot written and a lot said about Pakistan, whether there's been a failure of the imagination, whether we are living a nightmare, what has happened to Pakistan's dream. And at the same time, in a completely different context elsewhere, we are seeing people from Tunisia to Egypt and elsewhere reimagining their own countries. But I will leave it to the speakers to decide what they make of the question itself and what it means to them. We'll start first with Dr. Lodi.
Thank you. Thank you, Omar. Is this all right? I'm delighted to be here on an all-female panel. If we'd knocked out Omar and had another female to moderate us, it would have packed a lot more
punch. My apologies.
But let me start with a line from Alice in Wonderland, which goes something like this. If you don't know where you're going, any road will take you there. I think today's turmoil and turbulence is such that there is very little thinking going on that is warranted by the situation that we confront today. So I think what Omar said, and this session today, is an extremely important one, because it's devoted to the question of us asking ourselves, how is it that we imagine or reimagine Pakistan's future? What kind of a Pakistan do we want to see? I think the first principle must surely be that reimagining Pakistan must start by reversing the despondency that our nation has sunk into. Unless this is reversed, how can we marshal both the intellectual and political resources to have a vision that inspires hope for the future, that inspires the kind of national self-confidence that we seem to have lost? So I think there is no greater need today than to reimagine Pakistan's future. Equally, there is no greater need today than to reinvoke Jinnah's Pakistan, Jinnah's vision of what Pakistan was supposed to be. And I'm not going to spend time on this. I will only refer to a debate that is going on. We mustn't underestimate and underappreciate the fact that there is a debate of sorts. It should be much wider, it should be greater, about Jinnah's Pakistan. Are we losing it? Have we lost it? How do we reestablish it? How do we reclaim it? But I do want to draw a distinction very quickly between a dream and a vision. What I'm going to say, and what I have said about Jinnah's Pakistan, is not to invoke a mythical past or to recapture a lost dream. It is to invoke a vision. A dream inspires hope, but sometimes it's not implementable. A vision has to be implementable. It's a roadmap. It gives us the means to empower ourselves and to prepare ourselves for the future. So I want to make two broad points before I hand over to my other distinguished colleagues. The first I want to talk about quickly is a paradox that lies at the very heart of Pakistan's predicament today. And that I describe as a weak state, but a strong society. And I think there can be no greater testimony of this than what we have seen here all day today. If this is not the expression of a nation that is alive, of a nation that really can think for itself, I think we can find no better illustration of the fact that this is a lively and dynamic society. I think the great floods of last year provide us with the other example of how, when the state and the government foundered, society came through. And I'm not going to go into any detail because you're well aware. You're well aware of what happened at that time. It was the response, in contrast to the anemic response of the official machinery, it was the stellar contribution of civil society, the business community, ordinary citizens, to come to the rescue of the flood victims that really should have made all of us very proud of ourselves. So I think this offers a stunning contrast to faltering, weakening, or weaker state. There is another way in which a strong society is being juxtaposed to a weakening state or an eroding state. And this has to do with the changes that we're all living through today. The changes that have been brought about by socioeconomic factors despite successive governments, not necessarily because of them. These changes are changes of modern communications, changes in the broadcast media that is creating a more connected and a more empowered society. We simply know more about each other and about the world than we ever did. And it's connecting us in ways that I think we need to talk up our confidence all the time rather than talk it down. I think the moment has passed for us to keep diagnosing what's wrong with us, but to look at what's right with us. And here, I think a strong society has to do more than it's done in the last few years, which is simply to compensate for the inadequacies of the state or the government machinery. It has to become a powerful force for change in the way that we are governed and push for urgently needed reforms. Because for me, a reimagined Pakistan is a reformed Pakistan. And this brings me to my second point, which is, despite all our challenges and our problems, and we've had more than our share, some self-created, some not self-created. And I think we must be clear on that, instead of beating up on us all the time. We have much to answer for, but we've also been the victims of much that has happened over which we had little control. We may not have planned well, but we cannot attribute all that is wrong to us. We can attribute much that is wrong to us. So this brings me to my second point. And in any case, I think the means to self-empowerment, the means to national self-confidence lies in your self-belief. If we lose the belief in ourselves, all is lost. So my second point, quickly, I know Umar will get very impatient, I think comes from the point that we have been a country which has been more than one that simply lurches from crisis to crisis. That even in the midst of these crises, the level of functionality at the level of society has been constant. Dysfunctionality was at the level of the state and at the level of the government. Our society functioned, continues to function, despite and not because of a dysfunctionality. So I think the levels and layers of analysis that we adopt to look at ourselves in order to reimagine the future is critical. Otherwise, we will fall into deep depression out of which we will not be able to emerge. And I don't want to really rattle off what are the elements of our strength and the sources of us. We have an energetic free media, and as I said before, we have a lively arts, literature, and music scene. We have, in spurts, achieved high rates of economic growth, not nearly enough to attack poverty, not nearly enough to control our exploding population growth rate, but enough to give us some attributes, not sufficient, but some attributes of a modern nation. And I think we must always keep that side of the ledger in view as we examine ourselves. I think the difference between a successful nation and a successful state and an unsuccessful or a failing or a faltering one is good governance, is effective governance. That's what makes the difference between successful states and not so successful ones. And here, I do want to make a cluster of related points, which leads me to my final point of the need for reform in any reimagined Pakistan. And that has to do with the nature of representational politics in our country, which tends to produce what I call a democracy deficit. And here, before somebody attacks me, I think the choice for us is not between military rule and civilian democracy. That's a false choice. That's a false paradigm. The choice is between a functional democracy that is for everyone, chosen by everyone, but for everyone, and a dysfunctional democracy chosen by everyone, but for only some. Why do we produce this paradox? The reason is that representational politics in Pakistan is based on patronage. It is clientelist, and clientelist systems are basically based on trading political support for favors. It is necessarily local and parochial. It is inimical to thinking about national issues or national ways of solving problems. And most importantly, patronage-based systems may have worked in a different era and a different time. They are dysfunctional to the complex challenges of the era that we live in. So I do think that unless we are able to move away through electoral reforms, through political reforms, towards the kind of representational politics that reflects, one, the demographic reality of Pakistan, where the economic center of gravity has shifted from the rural to the urban centers, and where we are able to move away from patronage and towards thinking about policy aimed at benefiting all the citizenry, not some of the citizenry, in a patronage system. It is very difficult then to reimagine the kind of modern Pakistan that I think many of us in this room would like to see. So I would say this will have to be achieved through political reform, through electoral reform. And I think in redesigning this polity, two things will have to remain critical. First, that democracy will not function without the rule of law. There is no democracy without the rule of law. The two have to go together, or one perishes, or both perish. And secondly, that the military will have to subject itself to civilian oversight. But equally, the political class will have to stop asking the military to intervene to resolve its disputes. So I'll round off by saying that what we also need to secure our future is a new national narrative, and we heard much talk in the earlier session about narratives. We need a national narrative of hope, not despondency. And that comes from action, that comes from steps to reform, to rectify, and to revive ourselves. And the most important thing that we need to revive is an intangible. It is our self-belief. It is our confidence that we can transform ourselves and transform our society. We need to build a culture that pulls up rather than pulls down the nation's confidence. And ultimately, it's nations that believe in themselves that have the means to seize and transform their destiny. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Lodi. And now over to Dr. Aisha Sadiqa. How do you reimagine Pakistan?
That's a difficult one. I was watching this documentary at the dinner last night, which referred to, yes, things are bad, but there is some light at the end of the tunnel. There's some bright spots here and there. Dr. Lodi also talked about not being despondent, and I was thinking, the report, the recent UN report, is that parts of Sindh are Chad-like in terms of malnutrition. We've just had a governor killed. The government itself cannot publicly support the committees it has made itself to look into the blasphemy issue. And then we talk about despondency. My head spins. I'm trying to do in my time is to raise actually two questions. Yes, Pakistan can be reimagined. It can be the greatest nation in Asia. In fact, there are changes which are rapidly taking place in Asia, in larger Asian continent. There is ASEAN, which is already talking about bringing down barriers for people's free movement. So all of that is happening. And so where are we going to go? And the question which I want to raise, the first question which I want to raise is, when we think of reimagining Pakistan, do we have the capacity to do it? And I'll look at the question purely from my very narrow academic perspective. Please allow me to do that. Where is the capacity of a society to rethink, reimagine, where social sciences have died, have been killed, pushed to death systematically? Where are our histories? Where are our political scientists? I remember Hamza Alavi way back. But where is the next generation of Pakistani researchers, Pakistani social scientists? I don't see them anywhere. And the sad part is that this society actually doesn't think very seriously of social sciences. It's probably subjects that you study, probably to take the civil service exams. Nothing more. It's fundamental backbone of a society. So I'd question the capacity. Secondly, why do we have this session, Reimagining Pakistan? Has something gone wrong? Maybe there has. All this, what has happened very recently. But hang on. This is exactly the way Pakistan was imagined. And here, let me take a step back and question Dr. Lodhi's one basic assumption that Jinnah's Pakistan had to be secular. Where does it say? Except for that one speech that we all love to refer to. The fact of the matter is that once you create a state in the name of a religious identity, then state making is not static. It is an evolving process. And we are at the stage that we are for two reasons. One, fault is a manufacturing flaw. Secondly, we've had an educated liberal elite, most of it sits in this hall as well, which we had this design, two nation theory, wonderful. And then the ruling elite said, this religious discourse will now on be handled by the clergy. We'll just do the state running. But every now and then that we need to legitimize ourselves, we will borrow this discourse. And all liberal leaders have done that. So now, after 63 years, we have absolutely no control, no access to the discourse. We flounder, we're in a tizzy. Go get hold of Javed Ghamdi. Go get hold of Maulana Wajiuddin. Let them come on television screens and comment. But this is our evolution. And I think the problem for reimagining, for setting ourselves back on some track of rationality, we have to remember one thing, that we designed a state which based citizenship on the basis of its citizens' putative relationship with religion. And so now backing down is, perhaps not a possibility. I think in the foreseeable future, this is, the direction we'll take. Reimagining Pakistan, completely agree with, political reforms, changes. And again, two final points that I want to make. I think the problem in Pakistan, more than reforms or anything else, there is issue of reforms as well, is there are very few people in this country who have a sense of ownership of the state. You have the minority, you have religious minorities, you have ethnic minorities, you have, you know, women, you know, a sizable population which is off and on denied right to citizenship. I mean, let me relate very briefly a conversation which I had, you know, with a very educated person very recently. He was holding forth against this government, and he said, you know, this government is so bad. It's got three Ahmadis as senior secretaries governing. And I stopped this person and I said, are they Pakistanis or are they foreigners? And then it was this person's turn to stop and said, no, they were Pakistanis. So I said, what's wrong? Right? So one is that, ownership. You're poor, you don't have ownership. You're dispossessed, you don't have ownership. And by the way, the ruling elite doesn't have ownership either. Because a lot of them, an elite is not just the land-owning classes, it is the upper middle classes as well. Over so many years, Pakistan, the structure of Pakistan's elite has changed. We represent the elite as well. We like it or not. And the fact is that this elite has, half of them either have, you know, dual passports, or have enough capital to flee once push comes to shove. So, you know, one is that problem. The other is, you can reimagine, recreate a new Pakistan, provided we find a way to cut down or to manage the deep state, which has grown octopus-like. It is honestly like an octopus. It can comfortably break bread with the American during the day and sleep with the Taliban at night. And and it continues to do that. I mean, I'm sorry, in the recent months, in the recent weeks, what is unnerving a lot of people, you know, are these religious agitations. I don't call them Namus-e-Risalat, I call them Namus-e-ISI. And that has to go. That has to be managed. One very final comment is, you know, people got very excited in certain quarters and said, well, you know, Tunis, Egypt, yes, Pakistan. I don't think so. Reason is because all these clientelist networks, which includes the political parties, which includes the military, which includes intelligence agencies, are all partners, are all sleeping together. And that's where our problem lies.
Tahir Abdullah, how do you reimagine Pakistan?
How many hours are you giving me?
You've got 10 minutes.
Mushkil baat, assalamu alaikum, good afternoon. Mushkil baat ye hai, 63 baras ka rot aur 10 minute hame diye gaye hain ki hum koi jadoo ki chhadi yahan pe koi jadoo ki chhadi udaye aur wo ek second mein sab kuch theek thaak ho jaye. Zehra Nigah yahan par tashreef rakhti hain ya rakhti thi, shayad wo chali gayi hain kyunki हालात साजगार नहीं है. सुना है जंगलों का भी कोई कानून होता है और ये बहुत उम्दा और बहुत मायूसी से उठाने वाली एक नज्म है, बहुत तवील. मैं आपको उसके आखिरी दो मिसरे पढ़ के सुना देती हूँ. सुना है जंगलों का भी कोई कानून होता है, खुदावंदा जलील व मोतबर दाना मुनसिफ व अकबर, हमारे शहर में अब जंगलों ही का कोई कानून नाफिस कर दे. अब सब कहेंगे, मे आई रिक्वेस्ट दोज हु आर सिटिंग नेक्स्ट टू पीपल हु डोंट अंडरस्टैंड उर्दू टू काइंडली डू साइमल्टेनियस ट्रांसलेशन. दैट्स यू शबनम, दैट्स यू नईम, दैट्स यू. विल पीपल जस्ट प्लीज ट्रांसलेट, बिकॉज आई वुड हेट फॉर पीपल टू गेट बोर्ड इनफ टू वॉक आउट. मसला ये है कि कोई भी नहीं चाहेगा या चाहेगी कि जंगलों का कानून नाफिस कर दिया जाए. लेकिन जंगलों में जो कानून नाफिज है वहां शेर शेर को नहीं खाते, बिल्लियां बिल्लियों को नहीं खाती, कुत्ते कुत्तों को नहीं खाते, चूहे चूहों को नहीं खाते, खरगोश खरगोशों को नहीं खाते, एक दूसरे से लड़ते हैं। हायरार्कियां जरूर हैं जो कि बुरी बात है, उसके बारे में आगे जाके अगर जल्लाद ने इजाजत दी तो बात करेंगे, लेकिन लेकिन यह है कि लाइक एक दूसरे को नहीं खाते। हमारे यहां ये भी होता है, जब तालिबान हम में से दो तीन के ऊपर फतवा नाफिज कर रहे थे, सादिर कर रहे थे और उसकी तकमील के लिए इस्लामाबाद पहुंच गए, तो वो इंसान इंसान को खा रहा था। जब मुशर्रफ ने भी मुझे जेल में डाल दिया और जरदारी ने भी मुझे जेल में डाल दिया तो मुझे फख्र हुआ इस बात पे कि मैं शायद कोई चीज सही कह रही होंगी। हम बहुत तश्वीशनाक और फियर और डिस्पोंडेंसी के वक्त में रह रहे हैं। हम नाखुश हैं और नाखुशी के वक्त में जी रहे हैं। हम में से कुछ जी भी नहीं रहे उसके नीचे, उसके बारे में भी जाके आगे बात करेंगे। हमारी तमाम तर जो हमें स्पेस दी गई थी या जगह दी गई थी वो श्रिंक होती चली जा रही है। हम बोलने से डरते हैं, हम खड़े होने से डरते हैं, हम सड़कों पे आने से डरते हैं, अनलेस आवर नेम इज वुमेन्स एक्शन फोरम एंड सिटीजंस फॉर डेमोक्रेसी एंड नईम सादिक एंड ऑल माय फ्रेंड्स सिटिंग हियर एंड पीपल्स रेजिस्टेंस। लेकिन मुझे बताइए, 180 मिलियन की आबादी, 18 मिलियन का शहर कराची जिसमें आके मुझे बहुत मुसर्रत महसूस हो रही है, अगर 100, 200, 300, 400, 500, 1000, 2000, 5000 लोग भी अगर सड़कों पे निकल आए तो जो भी नहीं रेंगती। वो हंसता था डिक्टेटर कि ये गधे बेवकूफ सर फिरे जुनूनी कहते हैं कि हम चीफ जस्टिस को बहाल कर देंगे। हमने बहाल करवाया चीफ जस्टिस को और जुडिशरी को भी बहाल करवाया। मैं समझती हूं कि अगर हम जिंदा हो जाएं, अगर हम बाहर निकल आए, अगर हम अपने हुकूक को मांगे नहीं, हुकूक मांगते नहीं हैं, हुकूक वापस लेने की बात करें। डॉक्टर मलिहा लोधी सोचती होंगी कि मैंने तो 10 मिनट जाया कर दिए, मैंने होप की बात की थी, मैंने कहा था डिस्पोंडेंसी की बात नहीं करनी, वी मस्ट टॉक अबाउट व्हाट्स राइट विद पाकिस्तान नॉट व्हाट्स रॉन्ग विद पाकिस्तान। लेकिन जब तक हम ये बात नहीं करेंगे कि गुर्बत शौकत अजीज के झूठे फिगर्स 24% नहीं है, 51% गुर्बत है हमारे मुल्क के अंदर, और वो 51% वो हैं जो कि एक वक्त का खाना भी नहीं खा सकते, 75% वो हैं जो कि $2 a day के नीचे वाली गुर्बत में है। और आपको मालूम नहीं होगा, आप सिवाय सलमा वहीद के शायद किसी को यहां इस हॉल में ना मालूम हो, मैं चैलेंज करती हूं कि आप में से कितने लोगों को यह बात मालूम थी कि हर 4 पाकिस्तानियों में से 3 खवातीन होती हैं, यानी रेशियो ऑफ मेल फीमेल पॉवर्टी इज 1:3। ये कोई सोच भी नहीं सकता, आजकल के नौजवान यहां जो बैठे हैं उनको कोई ये बात बताने वाला नहीं है। 85% औरतें तशद्दुद का शिकार हैं, उनको मारें पिटती हैं, तेजाब गिराया जाता है और मार दिया जाता है। दुनिया भर की ऑनर किलिंग्स की, पूरी दुनिया में जितनी ऑनर इज्जत के नाम पर जो कत्ल किए जाते हैं, इससे ज्यादा बेइज्जती और बेगैरती कुछ नहीं होगी कि गैरत के नाम पर औरतों को कत्ल कर दिया जाए। आपको मालूम है कि पूरी दुनिया के जितने ऑनर किलिंग्स होते हैं 4000, उसमें से 2 से लेकर 2500 सिर्फ पाकिस्तान में होते हैं। 200 ममालिक हैं पूरी दुनिया में, कितने ममालिक में आप गिनवाना शुरू कर दें मुझे, जहां जिरगे और पंचायतें 8 औरतों को जिंदा दरगोर कर दें और 1 औरत को कुत्तों के आगे फेंक दें जो उसके पेट का बच्चा निकाल के खा जाए, और आप सेनेट में सेनेट का चेयरमैन, डिप्टी चेयरमैन, नेशनल असेंबली, प्रोविंशियल असेंबलीज के मिनिस्टर, कैबिनेट्स खड़े होके कहें हमें अपनी रिवायात पर फख्र है, ये हमारा कल्चर है, ये हमारी ट्रेडिशंस हैं, हम फख्र करते हैं, और फिर उस फख्र की पादाश में सदर मोहतरम आपको मिनिस्टर फॉर एजुकेशन लगा दें। कितने ममालिक हैं मुझे बताया जाए। हम मुतालबा करेंगे तो डॉक्टर मलिहा लोधी से सद माजरत के साथ, there is a lot wrong with Pakistan, but we know what is wrong, we know the diagnosis, hame prescriptions bhi maloom hai, hum karne ko taiyar nahi hai, hum we are too comfortable in our apathy and our silence. Hum apne aap ko silent majority kaha karte the, lekin maazrat ke saath kisi ki main dilazari nahi karna chahti, sama kharashi bhi nahi karna chahti, aur main kisi ki beizzati bhi nahi karna chahti. Hum jo apne aap ko silent majority kaha karte the, Salman Taseer ke murder ke baad aur aaj jo ke Shehri Rehman ko qatl karne ja rahe hain, hum unki hifazat karenge. Mujhe afsos ke saath ye kehna padta hai, aur ye bhi main ab sach bolne ja rahi hu, kisi ko acha lage ya bura, maazrat nahi karungi ki hum ab silent minority ban chuke hain. They are gaining the upper hand. We are letting them occupy our spaces. Why are we letting them occupy our spaces? We will not let them occupy our spaces. Lekin iske liye hame nizam badalna hoga. Hame sirf minister nahi badalne, hame sirf PPP ko PMLN se, ya PMLN ko PMLQ se, ya PMLQ ko kisi XYZ MQM se ya ANP jaise munafiqon se badalna padega. Nahi, ye nahi hoga. Sabse bade munafiq, by the way, ANP wale hain, usko kisi aur din ke liye chhod dete hain. जिन्होंने शरिया निजामे अदल राइज कर दिया है मालाकंड डिवीजन में, और वो आज राइज है, काजी कोर्ट्स फंक्शन कर रहे हैं. डरे आप उस वक्त से जब सिंध में भी ये होगा. मैं कहना ये चाहती हूं कि हमें निजाम की तब्दीली करनी होगी, और वो निजाम की तब्दीली इस तरह आएगी कि जागीरदारों को खत्म किया जाए, कबायली सरदारों को खत्म किया जाए, उसके साथ साथ पीरी मुरीदी की हेरेडिट्री पीरों को खत्म किया जाए. लैंड रिफॉर्म्स हमें चाहिए, एग्रीकल्चर इनकम टैक्स चाहिए, एग्रीकल्चर में बजटरी इन्वेस्टमेंट्स चाहिए. आपको मालूम है कि 75% हमारा बजट जाया करता था एग्रीकल्चर इन्वेस्टमेंट में, आज 25% से भी कम जाता है. हमें अपने तालीमी करिकुलम को तब्दील करना होगा. हमें एक तालीमी सिस्टम राइज करना होगा जहां ना कोई एलिटिस्ट है, ना कोई मदरसा है, ना कोई उर्दू है, ना कोई अंग्रेजी है, ना सिंधी है, ना पश्तो है, ना पंजाबी है. ये सब जबानें हमें सिखाई जाएंगी. अपनी मादरी जबान भी सिखाई जाएगी, उर्दू भी सिखाई जाएगी, और अंग्रेजी भी पहली जमात से सिखाई जाएगी. ये तबकाती निज़ाम को ख़त्म होना होगा, इन जिरगों और पंचायतों को ख़त्म होना होगा, औरतों को मर्दों की लड़ाइयों और ये वॉर्स और बैटल्स की भेंट नहीं चढ़ना होगा. रिलीजियस माइनॉरिटीज को इंसान समझा जाएगा और बराबर के इंसान समझा जाएगा. अदलो इंसाफ जहां पर होगा, यह है मेरा तसव्वुर पाकिस्तान के लिए. और आखिर में बोल के लब आजाद हैं तेरे, बोल जबां अब तक तेरी है, बोल ये थोड़ा वक्त बहुत है जिस्म जबां की मौत से पहले, बोल के सच जिंदा है अब तक, बोल जो कुछ कहना है कह ले.
Dr. Lodhi, Syra Abdullah made a couple references to what you said. Would you care to respond?
Sure. I think nobody can disagree with the series of reforms, if I may call them that, that Syra has rattled off. My point in saying that we should also look at how we can develop the means to empower ourselves is precisely to achieve those things. Slogans are not a strategy. Simply beating up on us all the time is also not a strategy. We've done that. We know the diagnosis. We know what's wrong with us. But unless we're able to lift ourselves from this gloom and doom, not by ignoring, but by focusing on the means to attack the sources of our weakness, we cannot take a step forward. So I think I am misconstrued when people think that I am ignoring everything and calling for hope. I call for hope because only nations that hope can reimagine their future. Nations that lose hope, lose confidence in themselves. Unless you have the self-confidence, you cannot begin the process of reform. Societies have to do that. And it is the responsibility of thought leaders in society to rise above slogans. Those are easy. The tough part is when the whole atmosphere is one of gloom and despondency, to get up and say, we can do it because we have done it in the past. Let's not forget two things very quickly. This nation's demise has been predicted every year that I have been alive. We defied the odds. We confounded the critics. We gave the lie to those who said this country will implode every year of the 63 plus years that we've been alive. If we do not look at that side of the picture, we have lost ourselves.
I need to respond to that. I have been misconstrued. Ek minute ji. Baat ab kyunki ho rahi hai to fir uska jawab bhi dena padega.
Briefly please.
Baat ye hai ki agar main na umeed hoti, agar main na umeed hoti, agar main samajhti ki umeed baki nahi hai, to main apne zindagi ke 2 saal chief justice aur judges ki bahali ke liye kabhi bhi na deti. Main earthquake 2005 aur IDPs 2009 aur floods 2010 mein jitna humne dekha hai naujawanon ko aur har tarah ke philanthropists ko, jahan state bilkul ghaib thi, state ne apni bunyadi zimmedari abdicate kar di thi, wahan hamari qaum zinda thi aur hum bhi zinda hain, aur main bahut pur umeed hu, aur main slogans nahi de rahi thi, maine 4 ya 5 points kahe the jo ke baqaida strategies thi, aur wo mera khayal lost in the shuffle kahin par ho gaye. 5 strategies maine di thi in addition to a slogan which I think is very important.
Okay, Aisha Siddiqui, you want to. Both of the other speakers mentioned a resilient society, a society which prospers even though the state is weak. But does this recent episode with the assassination of Salman Taseer and the threats faced by Sheri Rahman, the way that the killer, Mumtaz Qadri, was lionized, the way that any effort to reform this bill is not being allowed, the fact that you can't even mention this anymore, does that not reveal something very disturbing in the society?
See, that's the point which I've been trying to make. When we talk about Pakistan, where is Pakistan going? Why do we think that the people sitting in this room, it's their imagination which is important? The millions of ordinary Pakistanis, which included, by the way, Mumtaz Qadri as well, and many others, we have allowed, as intellectuals, as thinkers, we have allowed this thought process to come into place and become popular. You know, I would make a point that, you know, the fact that despite what people said about Pakistan being a failed state, it hasn't failed. Wow. Maybe if you look deeply, it's not just because we are brilliant, it's also because invasion of territory by others is no longer a favored formula. And failure is of several types. It's also a failure when your brethren or your brothers or sisters in one part of the other part of the country are absolutely in dark about what's happening to you. Or if one part of the country doesn't even know what is happening to you, there is that disconnect. And I don't think that we are kind of territorially drift away. I think that is another confusion that we have in our minds. A lot of Pakistanis would come to you and say, "Acha baat sunay, ye Pakistan jo ye toot jayega." And you're like, "Nahi, nahi, nahi, tootta nahi hai. Acha, jo, theek hai." After that, nobody wants to engage. Nobody wants to engage with the thought process that evolved. You know, Umar, last year I'd done a study which Newsline, Rehana is sitting here, the published part of it. This was about looking at socio-political attitudes of youth in elite universities in Lahore, Karachi, and Islamabad. IBA, the LUM, ZABIS, this, that, and the other. And it was interesting that there was, on critical issues, there was actually very little difference between how the madrasa kids thought and how these kids thought. The divides, ideologically, these divides are narrowing, and I think that is important. Highlighting the problems is probably a way to say that, you know, this is where the problem is, let's engage with it.
Dr. Lodhi, both of the other speakers made references to periods of military dictatorship, and particularly Dr. Aisha Siddiqui talked about a state which pursues a double policy of being intimate with militant groups and subsequently having this relationship with the US, and part of that touches on the clientism that you were talking about. Are we looking, I mean, is the dominance, is the preeminence of the military even during times of civilian rule a problem? You suggested that there should be some sort of civilian oversight. How do you see that changing?
No, I think you've asked several questions in one.
Well, they're all related to the preeminence of the military.
I don't know which aspect you'd like me to address, but I do think that unless civilian governments are able to strengthen the foundation and have policies of their own at a time when security issues predominate, it gives the military a greater voice and a greater role. So first of all, you start from that premise that half the time, if not most of the time, Pakistan's foreign policy has roughly been its defense policy. Okay? And because of that, it's had a larger than life role, either when it's been governing directly or when there are civilian governments.
Is that to do with the structure of the states?
Unless civilian political parties themselves also evolve alternate paradigms and have foreign policies, I mean, I've served in both kinds of governments. And I can tell you that the civilians need much greater space and confidence to also evolve their own sets of policies. So I think this is an issue for the times. But since you started with the whole US business, I can't resist but at least make one comment, which is I think the schizophrenia is on both sides. Let's not forget. If there's a schizophrenic approach to the United States in our country, that we want them as a friend but often don't know whether they're friend or foe, the same, I mean, I've served there as well. There's a mirror image there. They can't figure out either whether they are friends or foe. So there is a mirror image, and I think sometimes we look at ourselves in isolation to a broader context and a broader reality. We need to recognize that some relationships are very problematic. They are very difficult relationships.
It's a relationship built on security, and as you said, when it comes to security issues, the space for civilians diminishes.
Absolutely.
Some people like Itzhak Zessen.
Civilians also abdicate. That's my point.
Voices like Itzhak Zessen and even Najm Sethi and others suggest that Pakistan has become a national security state when it was first envisioned as a social welfare state. Is that where this country has gone wrong?
I think that's part of the problem, because I think that's true. But I think part of the problem is the need to also flesh out what a social welfare state is. Again, if that's left at the level of just a slogan, a desired outcome, with no strategy, with no political party which really has the means to spell that out and flesh that out, then it's very hard for that to be counterposed to the other side. So my point is that there is a greater challenge for civilian, particularly political parties, to be able to evolve the intellectual means to evolve that. It's no good just blaming everybody else. You have to have the means to then rectify it if you do not agree with it.
Tahir Abdullah, can Pakistan move from a national security state to a social welfare state?
We don't want a social welfare state. We want a human security state, not a social welfare. Social welfare implies charity, benevolence, giving. You know, a giver gives to a beneficiary. ہمیں چاہیے ایک ہیومن سیکیورٹی اسٹیٹ جہاں پہ تمام شہری جو ہیں وہ برابر کے ہوں, ان کو برابر کے حقوق ملے. اگر صحت ہمیں چاہیے تو سب کے لیے صحت ہو, تعلیم سب کے لیے ہو, سوشل سیکیورٹی اور پینشن سب کے لیے ہو, روزگار اور امپلائمنٹ سب کے لیے ہو اور تربیت سب کے لیے ہو. اس کے لیے ہمیں اپنے فوجی اخراجات کو کم کرنا پڑے گا. 39% ہمارا بجٹ جو فوجی اخراجات کے لیے جا رہا ہے, اس کو آہستہ آہستہ دونوں انڈیا اور پاکستان کو کم کرنا پڑے گا, اور فی الحال فریز کر دیں, اس کے بعد آہستہ آہستہ کم کرنا شروع کر دیں, اور 10% سے زیادہ نہ بڑھے, ताकि इन्फ्लेशन के साथ साथ बढ़ता चला जाए आपका फौजी बजट. मैं उन गधों में से नहीं हूं हेड इन द क्लाउड्स जो के कहे कि फौजी बजट को खत्म कर दो और आपके आपके एनिमीज आके आपके अंदर चले आए चलते चले आए मुल्क को कौम को लेने के लिए. लेकिन थोड़ा सा इसको रैशनलाइज करना पड़ेगा, इसको हमारी तरजीहात और हमारी प्रायोरिटीज को डिटर्मिन करना पड़ेगा और हमें दोस्तियां करनी पड़ेंगी, दुश्मनों को दोस्त बनाना पड़ेगा. और जिस मेज पर हम बैठेंगे इंडिया के साथ बात करने के लिए उसमें हमें कश्मीरियों को भी बिठाना पड़ेगा और अफगानिस्तान को स्ट्रेटेजिक डेप्थ नहीं दोस्त और बिरादर ममालिक के तौर पर सोचना पड़ेगा और हमशीरा ममालिक की तरह भी सोचना पड़ेगा.
Aisha Siddiqui.
Just a brief intervention. You know, let's imagine, Tahira, that for a minute, that, you know, we kind of stopped thinking of a bilateral something-something and completely, very selfishly focused on ourselves and say, all right, next 20 years, we are not going to increase our defense budget. We have these, you know, beautiful weapons of mass destruction to take care of any threat. We will freeze and bring down our defense budget wherever we can and invest, divert those resources towards social development, towards education, also, by the way, increase our state resources. We are right now caught in a situation where everybody is protecting their turf. For example, you know, when MQM talks about sugar mills and landowners, it forgets that, you know, there's a lot of big business which is in Karachi. Mia Nawaz Sharif doesn't want to tax his clientele as well. And, you know, the same applies to the PPP. So how do you increase resources? I think right now we have two kind of Pakistans in competition, contesting each other. One, which is currently imagined by the present setup, which says, here is the 18th Amendment, let's have provincial autonomy, let's devolve a lot of powers to the provinces, let them generate and then feed into the multiple and increase those multiple narratives that we should have owed, you know, earlier on. And the other is a national security state, that vision in which everything will be turned into, you know, color black or color green. And these two processes are now, as we speak, they are happening. And the question is that nothing will happen in a perfect space. It will happen with all the imperfections. The question is, what choice as an individual, which Pakistan are we going to select?
Okay, at this point, I'll open it up to the floor. We don't have much time, so please keep your questions to the point with rising inflection. I see Javed Jabbar has a question. And then we'll get to the rest. Is there a microphone? Javed Jabbar.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I am not going to win a popularity contest in this session. First of all, congratulations on hosting a new kind of TV talk show. Because with great respect, I have respect for all three eminent panelists. But I am alarmed at how close I am to Dr. Maliha Lodhi. Even though I have been with her as friend and partly as foe, I find myself in complete agreement with Dr. Maliha Lodhi. And the reason I do that, I do not question the patriotism and the loyalty of the other two eminent panelists. But this is a moment in Pakistan's history when we have to look at tomorrow, when we have to look at our own souls and see the strengths that lie within ourselves. And not look at the darkness that's spread every evening by the TV talk shows or by the conditions around us. And I'm very unfortunately disappointed by your remark about the fact that after Mumtaz Qadri's bestial act against Salman, we have not been able to raise a voice. I have had the dubious privilege of appearing on a TV talk show in Urdu, and those were only one of several TV talk shows. People have written, people have condemned this.
Absolutely.
And Pakistanis have a capacity to compartmentalize their reaction. There are some of us who allow that kind of extremism to run into other parts of their lives, but that phenomenon does not represent the main character and psyche of the Pakistani people, who are overwhelmingly liberal, progressive, Sufi in their orientation. And that will be the true Pakistan of the future.
Just as a point of just as a point of clarification, Mr. Jabbar, I was not referring to, I merely raised the question that to see lawyers celebrate the killer, to have even that as a section of it, it's not the dominant action, but I was made, I think it's a legitimate question. Of course, and these aren't problems returning anywhere. I mean, this is... No, but this is somewhere to be discussed. Anyway, we'll move on to other questions. Yes, in front here.
Good afternoon. While listening to Dr. Malia Lodhi, and I strong... Language is reflects mindset, and you're referring to Tahira's list of strategies as rattling off. It just... my question to Dr. Lodhi is that she mentioned some forces affecting Pakistan's decision making and strategies, and some injustices done to us. I would like her to highlight those beyond our control things, non-self-created things. That is one my one question. And secondly, I would like to know her position on blasphemy law, and if she's pro-reforms, will she push those reforms through her influential position in media and otherwise?
Dr.
And as an insider, I'd like you to highlight that.
I just have one answer to your question. This session is not about me.
No.
It's about my country.
No.
It's not about me and my positions, personal or otherwise. This session is about reimagining Pakistan. I have my concept of how I look at my country's future. You may or may not agree. She has hers, and Tahira has hers. And I think that was the purpose of this session, to have a plurality of views, to give you a menu. So I'm not here to promote my views. I'm here to promote my country.
Okay. We have just one final question. We have to wrap this up and go over there. Is there a microphone, please? Yeah, could you pass it? Okay, fine. Please go.
Is it on? Okay. My question is especially to Ms. Aisha Siddiqua. It is that what can we do about the extreme religious views gaining ground among Pakistanis and the youth especially, and what is the remedy to it, or is it really what Islam is all about? We have to, I think, all of us have to rethink what values we hold dear in our religion.
Okay, Aisha, very quickly, it's the last comment.
Extreme religious views, and you know, what do we do about it? Is it part of Islam? No, I don't think so. I think the problem we've had for so long is that because, what I mentioned earlier, that because the educated people, the liberal progressive people, have stayed away from religious discourse for such a long time, the state of the religious narrative is where it is at the moment. Now, like wonderful elite, we kind of fool ourselves when we say that, you know, we are believers in this great Barelvi Islam, the Sufi Islam, which is going to turn things around. No. The discourse, the narrative, the religious, social religious narrative in this country, in most Muslim societies, is static. It needs our input. And I think our, for example, I think for Pakistan to go ahead, we have to put a distance between religion and the state. it is necessary, so that a citizen is a citizen, irrespective of what they believe in, what faith do they have. Pakistan, the latent radicalism that is growing in this country is about our inability to imagine the other. Things are happening. And I think one way, I mean, I would, you know, I with due respect, it's not about losing hope. I think the reason I am standing here and saying whatever is because I believe in this country and I want us to live in a better environment, right? The point is that we have to look at the threat, look at the challenges head on. Not hide and say, no, we can do this and we can do that. We have to calculate what our capacity is. And I think we have a capacity problem.
Okay, we'll make one very, very quick final question, and then we've got the Bollywood's India and Lollywood's Pakistan session here. So please keep it quick.
Okay, I'll have to... my question is to Aisha. It was first of all a pleasure to listen to all of you, including the moderator. My question is to Aisha Siddiqa. Kal mein ek art exhibition pe gayi thi jahan par unka the artist was trying to tell us that we don't have a hero or a heroine amongst us anymore. So do you think we don't have a hero or a heroine? Do you think there is a need for a new political party to surface as well?
You mean other than the three heroes on the panel?
Okay. Other than the three, yes, absolutely. Okay.
All right. Actually, no, we'll put that finally to each of the three panelists and then we'll end there. So let's start with Dr. Lodhi and then we'll come across and end that. Do we have any heroes in Pakistan? Is there anyone left to inspire Pakistanis?
I think the heroes of Pakistan are the people of Pakistan. There's no question in my mind. The heroes of Pakistan are ordinary Pakistanis. And I will repeat something that I said before. We have to get past the past. We have to look at the future. We know our past. There's no point wallowing in it. We mustn't live in it, but we must learn from it. It's a difference between the two. Now, as far as whether we need, I think we need reform in the kind of representational politics that we have, either by influencing the existing political parties to move away from the patronage and spoil system that they operate towards policy, towards reform, towards changing Pakistan. And if they are unable to do it, and I think this is a question only the audience can answer, which is, have they evolved the intellectual capacity to do that? Question. And if they haven't, then is there time for us to seek the urban middle class of Pakistan to seek a new political vehicle that can lead the way for the transformation of Pakistan along the lines that Aisha has said and along the lines that Tahira have said, which I entirely agree with. I have no disagreement on the substance of what they say. My disagreement is with how do we take this forward? We must develop those means and we must have faith in ourselves and empower ourselves.
Aisha, are there heroes in Pakistan?
I think more than heroes, the right word is icons, right? We killed our icons. And again, because of the close linkage between religion and the state, right? Our icons have to be, what the state allows. They cannot be Dr. I mean, our icon just cannot be Dr. Abdus Salam because he's Ahmadi. Our icon cannot be anyone who is not probably Deobandi, Wahhabi, Muslim. So we have a problem. We need to create. Look, I grew up in a Pakistan which had icons. I remember Sufi Ghulam Mustafa Tabassum. I remember, and I think a lot of you remember Faiz Ahmed Faiz, right? There were a lot of icons, we buried them. And the problem is that the state has been so much in bed, stirring this connection between religion and politics. I mean, we come and speak to you here in Sindh, and the fact is that today, the deep state is trying to to convert Upper Sindh the same manner that it has converted my part of the country, that is South Punjab, by opening madrasas, by opening militant outfits and supporting them. That needs to be stopped.
That will have to be discussion for another moment. Finally, Tahira, please.
بہت شکریہ آپ نے ایک بہت اہم سوال پوچھا ہے اور مجھے خوشی ہے کہ ایک نوجوانوں میں سے کم از کم ایک سوال تو آیا اور وہ میں نے بہت زور کیا تھا تو آیا جی ہاں میرے نظر میں پاکستان میں ہیروز اور ہیروئنز کی کمی نہیں ہے اور وہ ہیں وہ 64% آبادی جو کہ نوجوانوں پر مشتمل ہے The 64% of Pakistan's population that comprises our youth آپ ہمارے ہیروز اور ہیروئنز ہیں اور اگر آپ ہماری غلطیاں نہ دہرائیں ہماری غلطیوں سے سیکھ کر آگے بڑھیں تو میں سمجھتی ہوں کہ امید کبھی نہیں ہم چھوڑیں گے اور پاکستان کا مستقبل بہت روشن ہے اور میری ہیرو وہ بھی عورتیں ہیں وہ 85% پاکستانی عورتیں جو کہ روزانہ رات کو مار پیٹ کر کے مار پیٹتی ہیں اور مار کھاتی ہیں اور صبح کے وقت اٹھ کے پراٹھا اور چائے بنا کے اپنے شوہر کو کھلاتی ہیں
I just have one announcement. Bollywood's India and Lollywood's Pakistan, talk by Rachel Dwyer and Javed Jabbar, moderated by Muneeb Ahmed, will be taking place in this room now. Thank you very much.